In this lecture, we are going to understand what is testing. We have two learning objectives under this topic. First objective is identify typical objectives of testing, and it is marked as K1. That means the questions are going to be direct from this topic. So you just need to remember the points. Second objective is differentiate testing from debugging. It is marked as K2. That means you need to understand this topic. But before we start with these objectives, we shall understand what is testing. So first of all, what we need to know is, in this syllabus, we need to understand testing in the context of software. That means we will discuss only about software testing. So what is software testing? Software testing is a way to assess the quality of the software and to reduce the risk of software failure in operation. Now let's try to understand this. Once the developer develops software, the software is not directly given to the user. Before giving it to user, the software undergoes a process to find out defects and risk associated with the software. And this process is called testing. And in context of software, this process is called software testing. Now let's see some application of software. First example is business application, and the second one is customer product. Example of business applications are when you go to airport to book your tickets, or when you go to supermarket to buy some items, or when you are working at your office. Software are all around us. And the example of customer products are washing machine, mobile phones, or coffee maker machine. They all contain software within them. So what is our expectation from these softwares? Our expectation is they shall work correctly whenever we use them. And to ensure this, testing of software is required. What will happen if the software does not work correctly? Such software are called as faulty software. And a faulty software can result in loss of money, time, reputation, or in extreme cases can result in injury or death. Now let's see some real-time example to understand this. This news was in market that one particular car company recalled 2,000 of its car due to issue with the front passenger airbag. Once such news hits the market, the share value of company goes down and results in huge loss of money. Now let's move to the second example, that is time. Once this car is in the garage, they undergo repair, and at the same time, the company has to do damage control, and all of these things takes a lot of time. Now let's move to the third example, that is loss of reputation. In 2014, there was a breach in security aspect of eBay software. That means the software was compromised. It was not working as expected. And if such news comes out, it results in loss of reputation. Now let's see the last example, that is injury or death. For an example, if the airbag system does not work as expected, then it can result in injury or death. So these were the four impacts of faulty software: loss of money, time, reputation, and injury or death. Now we will see some of the misconceptions about testing. First misconception is, testing only consists of running test cases, which is completely wrong, as testing is a process and it consists of many activities as listed here. It consists of test planning, test monitoring and control, test analysis and design, test implementation and execution, and finally test completion. We will discuss about each of these activities in detail in our future lecture. But for time being, you need to remember these activities in the same order as listed here. Second misconception is, testing only involves the execution of the component or system being tested. This is also false, as testing consists of both dynamic and static testing technique. In dynamic testing, code is executed, whereas in static testing, code is not executed. I will provide detailed lecture on this topic. For time being, just remember, testing consists of dynamic and static testing techniques. And the last misconception which we are going to discuss in this lecture is, testing focuses entirely on verification of the requirement. This is also false, as testing focuses on both verification and validation of the requirement. Verification means to check, are we building product right? Whereas validation means to check if we built the right product. So verification comes into picture in the starting of the project, and validation comes into picture at the end of the product. So again, I will provide detailed lecture to explain difference between both. As of now, just remember, testing focuses on verification and validation of the requirement. Before we end this lecture, let's have a look into the important points. Testing is done to assess the quality of the software and to reduce the risk of software failure in operation. Next point is, faulty software can result in loss of money, time, reputation, and injury or death. Testing is a process and consists of different activities: test planning, test monitoring, test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution, and test completion are the 7 different activities described in this syllabus. And the last important point is, testing consists of static and dynamic testing and consists of verification and validation process. All these important points are available as a resource and attached to this video. Please find them. Now we are going to discuss dynamic testing versus static testing. The first point of difference is, static testing is done without execution of code, whereas in dynamic testing, we are executing the code. Let's try to illustrate this with an example. Let us say that we have a customer requirement that states, window shall move up when up button is pressed and shall move down when down button is pressed. To fulfill this requirement, you have to write a code for it. Now, suppose a developer has written this piece of code. This is a function where he is trying to implement the customer's requirement. When button is pressed, if button equals to up, then move up, otherwise move down. Our task as a tester is to check whether this piece of code is satisfying the requirement or not. And this type of testing is known as static testing. So let's try to test this piece of code. Here it says, if up button is pressed, then move up. But if up button is not pressed, then move down. If you execute this code, then the window will never stop moving. It will move up when up button is pressed. But the moment you release the button, it will start moving down. This means this piece of code is not fulfilling the requirement. So this is how we find defect through static testing. Why do we call this static? Because when I was performing this test, the code was not moving. It was in one place. This is why this type of testing is called static testing. So this is it from static testing. Now let's move to the dynamic part. Dynamic testing requires you to study the behavior. Here, if you press the button or if you press the down button, then the window moves down. You aren't bothered about the code or how it is written. When you press the up button, the window will move up, and when you press the down button, it will start moving down. So here what you need to remember is, static testing is carried out without the execution of code, while dynamic testing requires execution of code. Now let's move to the second point in their difference. Static testing is conducted in the verification stage, whereas Dynamic testing is performed in the validation stage. Let's find out what they mean by verification stage and validation stage. So here we have the life cycle of a software development activity. First you have a user requirement, next a system requirement, then a global requirement. After that you have a detailed design. Once you have a detailed design, then you can start writing a code. Now, static testing is done in the early stages when you only have the documents. As you can see, you don't have the code here. And if you don't have a code, then you cannot run a software. When we have only documents, then we can only perform a static testing. We can carry out a verification because we cannot run the code. So there are two stages. The first part is for static testing, but once the code is ready, you can perform the dynamic testing because now you can run the code. So this is why static testing is done in the verification stage, whereas dynamic testing is done in the validation stage. Now let's move to the third difference. Static testing is cost effective, whereas dynamic testing is less cost effective. Let's try to understand this. As we saw this diagram, let's assume you were in the requirement stage and you found the defect in the requirement stage itself. Since you found defect in the same stage, cost to fix the defect is less. But suppose you are in the dynamic testing, that means you are already here. Now, if you find the defect at this stage, and after analysis you come to know this defect is present here because of the requirement, then you have to change all these documents. This will require more people to solve the problem, and this will cause more. So this is the reason we said static testing is cost effective, whereas dynamic testing is less cost effective. Before we end this lecture, let's have a look into the important points. The first point is, static testing is conducted without execution of code. Dynamic testing requires execution of code. Second point is, static testing is performed in the verification stage, whereas dynamic testing is performed in the validation stage. Third point is, static testing is cost effective, while dynamic testing is less cost effective. And there is a fourth point about example that I want to add here. Static testing examples are walkthrough and code review, whereas with dynamic testing, you have to perform functional or non-functional testing. Thank you. In this lecture, we are going to see the objective of testing. Let's have a look into the first objective of this syllabus. Just remember, you need to know this objective as it is, as question will come directly from this topic since it is marked as K1. Before we jump to the objectives, you must know these important terms which we are going to use in this lecture. We should know what is the meaning of work product and test items. Work product means output. Let's understand this. These are the steps followed during development of software in an organization. First step is to get users requirement, then we develop system requirement, then comes the global design, next is detailed design, and last step is implementation where software is developed. So when we say work product, in the system requirement stage, the output is system requirement. So system requirement will become our work product. Similarly, in the global design and detailed design stage, the output is design document. So our work product will be design document. And in the implementation stage, the output is code or software. So then the work product will be code here. So we have to keep in mind, work product means output. Now, the next term is test item, which is also known as test object. It is any document or component or system which is under test. Let's see an example to understand this. In the requirement stage, requirement is our work product. And if this has to be reviewed, then requirement is referred as test item. Similarly, if we are in implementation stage, the output of this stage is code. And if we want to perform testing on it, then code is our test item here. So, output of the stage is called work product, and if testing is performed on it, then it is called as test item. So what we can say here is, any document or component or system which is under test is referred as test item. So this is the first objective, to evaluate work products such as requirement, user stories, design and code. We already know work product means output, and the output of requirement stage is requirement document where all the requirements are mentioned. Now, as per the first objective, we need to evaluate this work product. So let's see an example to understand this. Suppose this is the customer requirement. For web page, when the login details are given, the next page shall load in few milliseconds. And if login details are not correct, then show a pop-up. But if you look this requirement carefully, then you will find that this is not complete. There are some open points. For an example, how much time? They have mentioned few milliseconds, but the timing should be specific here, which is not. So this is an open point for us. Second point is, which page will load next? This is also not given. They are saying next page shall load, but what will be the content of that page? That is not mentioned. And the third open point is, what is the pop-up content? They are saying the pop-up should appear, but what will be the content of that pop-up is not mentioned here. So this requirement is not complete, and therefore these are the questions which we need to clarify. So this is why it is necessary to evaluate work products such as requirement, user stories, design and code. Now, the second objective states, to verify whether all specified requirements have been fulfilled. Let's try to understand this. We already know this requirement. Now, we need to see if these requirements are fulfilled in the engineering requirement. After analyzing the customer requirement and asking questions, we finally have the engineering requirement, which includes the following points. Login is correct, go to the next page. Next page shall load in 500 milliseconds. Next page shall contain the personal information. If the login detail is not correct, pop-up shall appear. And the pop-up message is password or user ID is incorrect. So now you can see, by asking question, we got all the missing information which we included in the engineering requirement. So like this, in each stage, we have to verify whether all specified requirements have been fulfilled or not. Now third objective is to validate whether the test object is complete and works as the user and other stakeholders expect. As we know, test object means object under test, and it is defined as the component or system to be tested. So when we are in the requirement stage, requirement is our test object. When we are in the design stage, design is our test object. And when we are in the implementation stage, code is our test object. Now let's continue with our example. As per third objective, we need to provide input to the test object and check the output, if it fulfills the stakeholder's requirement or not. This means once the software is ready, we need to execute it to see if it fulfills the customer requirement. And since we are executing the code here, this comes under validation. So third objective is to validate whether the test object is complete and works as user and other stakeholders expect. The fourth objective is to build confidence in the level of quality of the test object. Let's understand this. Suppose we are in the requirement stage, then requirement is our test object. And if we clarify all our requirements in this stage itself, instead of clarifying it during the implementation stage, then we can build confidence in our requirement and finally in our product. Because if we clarify requirement during the implementation stage and if we find any mistake, then all the previous documents requires a change, and doing that will be a costly process. And that is why it is necessary to build confidence in the level of quality of the test object. Now let's discuss objective 5 and 6 together. Objective 5 is to prevent defects, and objective 6 is to find failures and defects. Let's understand this objective. If you find defect in the requirement stage, you prevent this defect to go to the next stage. Now objective 6 into comes into picture. We need to find the defect or failure in the same stage in which they are tested. Otherwise, defect will travel to the next stage and it will be more costly to fix. And this is the reason, this is one of the important objective of testing, to prevent defect and to find failure and defects. The seventh objective is to provide sufficient information to stakeholder to allow them to make informed decision, especially regarding the level of quality of the test object. So when we find defect, it's not necessary that we will fix all of it before release. But what we can do is to provide sufficient information to the stakeholder so that they can take decision based on the defect and risk associated with it. Now, the eighth objective is to reduce the level of risk of inadequate software quality, that is, previously undetected failure occurring in operation. The objective is related to fifth and sixth objective. We need to find the defect in the same stage in which they are introduced. Otherwise, it will be found in the operation. If fault is found during operation, it can have adverse effect. And that is why it is necessary to reduce the level of risk of inadequate software quality. The ninth objective is to comply with contractual, legal, or regulatory requirement or standards to verify the test object's compliance with such requirement or standard. Sometimes you need to fulfill the legal requirements. For an example, if you are working for automotive industry, then you need to fulfill ISO 26262 standard for safety critical requirements. Same goes with the contractual requirement. If you have made any contract with the customer, then during testing you have to see whether you have fulfilled those requirements or not. And that is why this objective come into picture. To comply with contractual, legal, or regulatory requirements or standards to verify test object's compliance with such requirement or standards. Till now, we discussed general testing objectives, whereas the objectives are context dependent. To understand this, let's have a look into two different testing levels, component level and acceptance level. When you perform testing at component level, your objective is to find as many defects as possible so that they are not found during operational use. Whereas, if you are in the acceptance level, your objective is to check if system works as per the customer's requirement. So that is all you need to check here. Before we end this lecture, let's have a look into the important points. So you need to remember all the points the way it is written here. First objective is to evaluate work products such as requirement, user story, design, and code. Second objective is to verify whether all specific requirements have been fulfilled. Third objective is to validate whether the test object is complete and works as the user and other stakeholders expect. Fourth objective is to build confidence in the level of quality of the test object. Fifth objective is to prevent defects. Sixth objective is to find failures and defects. Seventh objective is to provide sufficient information to stakeholders to allow them to make informed decision, especially regarding the level of quality of the test object. Eighth objective is to to reduce the level of risk of inadequate software quality. Example, previously undetected failures occurring in operation. Ninth objective is to comply with contractual, legal, or regulatory requirements or standards to verify the test object's compliance with such requirement or standard. And at the end, we need to know objective of testing is context dependent. Thank you.
In this lecture, we are going to understand about testing and debugging. And this is the second objective of this syllabus. You need to understand this topic since the topic is marked as K2. Do not expect direct question from it. First, we will have a look into the testing activities. So the first activity is, and the most important activity of testing is, to show failure. Because by now we know that one of the objective of testing is also to find defects. Now what we need to understand is, finding defect is not only activity of testing. Other activity of testing is, once the defect is found, it is very much required to check if found defect is fixed or not. And the last point is, testing is done by testers. Now let's have a look into the debugging activities. The most important activity of debugging is to analyze failure. And once the failure is analyzed and the root cause is found, the next activity is to fix the defect. And the last point is, debugging is done by developers. Now here we will understand how tester and developer work with respect to defect cycle. First, tester finds the defect. Then the found defect is reported to the development team. After getting the defect report, development team starts investigating the failure. While investigating the failure, developer isolates the defect from rest of the software. Once the defect is isolated, developer fixes the defect and then checks if defect is fixed or not. Once the defect is fixed, the fixed report is sent to the testing team. After getting the fixed report, the testing team retests on the found defect to confirm if they are really fixed or not. So this is how tester and developer works with respect to the defect cycle. Now one more point to remember is, in agile development and in some other life cycle, tester may be involved in debugging and component testing. Though in general, debugging is developer's task, but in agile development model, which is very iterative, sometimes debugging is done by testers. Now let's see the difference between testing and debugging. The very first difference is, testing is performed by tester and debugging is performed by developers. Second difference is, testing finds the programming failure, whereas debugging is to demonstrate that program is working fine, otherwise show the cause of the defect. Now the last difference over here is, testing is done with the purpose of finding bug, whereas debugging is done to find the cause of the bug. Before we end this lecture, let's have a look into the important points. So the first point is, in agile development and in some other life cycle, tester may be involved in debugging and component testing. Then we learned about testing and debugging activity. Testing activities are finding defect and confirming defects are fixed, whereas developer's activity is to analyze defect and fix those defects. With this, we end this lecture here.
In this lecture, we are going to address why is testing necessary. In order to understand this, we must remember that all of us are human, and being human, we make mistakes, and those mistakes can be very expensive. The expense can be loss of money, it can be crucial loss of time, it can also be loss of business reputation, and the final and gravest loss is death or injury due to our mistake. So in order to avoid these losses and to minimize risk, we have to test every single aspect of our product. Now let's take a look into three more important points for a better understanding of why is testing necessary. First point is related to risk. We perform testing to reduce the risk associated with the product. And how do we do that? By detecting the defect, which is our next point. So we have to detect defect so that they are not seen in operational use. So when the user is using our product, they should not be able to find these defects. It's our responsibility to find them first through testing. The third point is meeting the contract. So we have to make sure that we are meeting all the commitments we made to our customer. So if the customer asks for something that is not included in the contract, this is where we find it. So these are the reasons testing is necessary to the process of product development. Now let's see an example to understand this. Suppose there is a developer who works on a code and creates a software. He then directly hands over this software to the customer. Now that the customer has the software, he uses it, but soon becomes very disappointed. Why? Because he has found an error in the software. So now the question arises, why did the customer find the error and not us? The answer is that once the software was developed, he handed it over directly to the customer instead of going through this rigorous process of testing. If we had put this product through this process, it is possible that we could have caught this error before it is ever reached to the customer. And this is where I have to mention something crucial. We have to perform appropriate testing at appropriate levels. So now let's have a look into these different levels of development activities. So the first level is requirement. And in our coming videos, we will see how testing requirement contributes to success. The second level is the design stage. Here we will see how testing design contributes to success of the project. After design comes coding. And here we will see how testing coding contributes to success. And finally, the software is ready and we will analyze that what kind of software testing will contribute to the success of the product. So if we carry out testing at each level, then we will achieve a successful product. Before we end this lecture, let's have a look into different topics which we are going to cover under this section. So the first topic is give an example of why testing is necessary. Next is describe the relationship between testing and quality assurance and give examples of how testing contributes to higher quality. Next is distinguish between error, defect and failure. And last one is distinguish between the root cause of a defect and its effect. If you see all these topics, they are marked as K2. That means we have to understand this topic in order to answer them. So the first topic is already covered. We have already seen an example of why testing is necessary. So next we are going to address the second topic. Thank you. The first topic under this session is testing's contribution to success, where we will see how testing at different level contributes to success. The different level of software development cycles are requirement level, where software requirements are written. Then comes the design level, where design is made. After that comes the coding level, where code is implemented. And then finally comes the complete software, which is ready for testing. Now with example, we will try to understand how testing at these levels contribute to success of overall product. So now let's discuss the first level of testing during development process, and that is the requirement level. Here we will understand how testing during the requirement level will contribute to the success of whole project. In this level, we start by reviewing the requirement. Reviewing is nothing but static testing. So we are performing static testing on the requirements. We are also doing this to detect the defect in these work products. Here, of course, the work product are just the requirement. So why are we reviewing this requirement? Is to reduce the risk of incorrect or unstable functionality being developed, which means if there is something wrong or incorrect in the requirement and we don't spot it, then that is how the entire project will be developed. And this is what we have to stop by performing testing on the requirement. To understand this, let's have a look into the software development levels. These are the different levels in software development. First, you have the user requirement. Then you have a system requirement. Now, if we don't correct the error at this level, it goes on and becomes part of the global design and detailed design, both of which will be wrong. And eventually, we will have a software that does not work correctly. So, this is why if we correct the requirement at this stage, the rest of the process will carry out without error. And this is why we say testing at requirement contributes to the success of product. Now let's discuss the second level of testing during development process, and that is at the design level. At design level, there will be a system design. Our job is to do a review on it. Since there is no code, we cannot run it. Therefore, we review it, which is a static testing technique. When we do this review, it will increase team members' understanding. So, whether it is a tester, developer, or any other process guy, everyone will have the same understanding after this review. If everyone has the same understanding or knowledge, it will help to reduce the risk of fundamental design defects. So, a review of system design will reduce the risk of fundamental design defects. Now let's go back to our chart. Right now, we are at the global or detailed design stage. If we carry out our testing here and catch the mistake, then it will not go to the implementation stage. We will send the correct software to the dynamic testing and the product will be a success. If we don't do testing, then we will send a faulty software for dynamic testing, and then we will be forced to go back two steps to find the error. And for this, we have to spend additional time and effort. I hope that it is obvious now why testing at design level is so important. It's because it contributes to the success of the whole project. Now let's discuss the third level of testing during development process, and that is the coding level. So how does testing coding contributes to success? In the coding level, you have code under development. The code is being developed and you will perform a static testing on it. The intention with this is to increase the understanding of the piece of code. By doing this, we reduce the risk of defect within the code. So if there are any defect, we can find them out by reviewing the code through static testing. Now let's see an example to understand how reviewing code can find defect. Suppose this is the requirement. Check window moves up within 10 milliseconds once the button is pressed. For this requirement, the developer has written this code. Try and see if you can tell what's the mistake in this code. The function looks right, but see here. The developer has written if button is pressed for 10 milliseconds or less, then the window will move up. The requirement was for window to move up within 10 milliseconds and not at 10 milliseconds. The developer has introduced this equal to sign which changes the result. Now, the window might not move up unless exactly 10 milliseconds have passed. So this is how performing testing at coding level can reveal mistake in the code and contribute to the success of whole project. Now let's discuss the final level of testing during development process, and that is the software level. So let's find out how testing at software contributes to the success of the project. Once the software is ready, we verify and validate the software. Now that the software is functional and the code is ready, we can perform dynamic testing on it. Once we perform the dynamic testing, we detect failure that might otherwise have been missed. If we don't do the testing at this level, then there is a fair chance that we will miss some error, and they will finally be discovered when the software is in operational use. Next is removing the defect that causes the failure. So we will fix the problem because of which the software is failing. This is where the debugging process comes into picture, which we discussed previously. The tester finds the error and tells the developer, who fixes the problem and sends it back to the tester to confirm that error is gone. And by doing all this, our software will meet the stakeholders' need, and it will meet the customer or the user's requirement, and that means everyone using the software will be happy. So this is how testing at software level helps the product succeed. Thank you. In this lecture, we will focus on quality assurance and testing. Here we will address the second topic of this session. And at the end of this lecture, you have to understand the relationship between quality assurance and testing. So the first concept is quality assurance, which is also called as QA. And the second concept is testing. People often think that quality assurance and testing are the same. This is a mistake. They are not same, but they are related. How they are related? They are related through a large concept known as quality management, and this concept ties them together. So you have to remember that while quality assurance and testing are not the same, they are related by a large concept called quality management. And before we have a look into these terms, let's understand this concept first. First, in an organization, we established quality management. Now, the quality management has quality assurance as a subsystem to ensure that quality requirements will be fulfilled with the help of standards and procedures. Inside QA, we have quality control to check if quality is fulfilled or not. This checking is done using different testing techniques. So this is how we have to remember the whole concept of quality assurance, testing, and quality management. Now let's deal with each of these topics one by one. The first topic is quality management. This is a series of coordinated activities to direct and control an organization with regards to quality. So we are establishing a quality management system in an organization, and the objective of this management system is to achieve the quality requirement of the organization. So what is quality management? It is a larger system introduced into an organization with the single goal of achieving the best quality. The next term is quality assurance. This is a part of quality management. Quality management is a bigger system, and out of that we get quality assurance. And the purpose of quality assurance is to focus on providing confidence that quality requirements will be fulfilled. And the final topic is quality control or testing. We already have a management and we have a standard and procedure. Now we need to implement these concepts, and this implementation is done by quality control. It is the operational techniques and activities part of quality management that are focused on fulfilling quality requirements. So quality management is a larger system which has two parts, quality assurance and quality control. Quality assurance contains all the documents that tells us what procedures to follow, and quality control is the activity that we have to perform in order to achieve organization's quality requirement. So this is how you have to remember these three things. Quality control is an activity. Quality assurance is a document or a procedure. And quality management is a complete system under which quality assurance and quality control works. Now let's look into these concepts a little more. Quality assurance and quality control. So quality assurance contains proper processes like standards and procedures, while quality control has test activities. So this has activities and this has processes. Quality control is a practical approach, whereas quality assurance is theoretical. The next point is to look at is quality assurance is more about defect prevention by laying out guidelines, procedures, standards. This helps prevent defects. But quality control is a defect detection mechanism. So these are the clear differences between quality assurance and quality control. Before we end this lecture, let's have a look into the important points. So the first point is quality management ties quality assurance and testing. Quality assurance is not same as testing. Third point is very important. Quality is confirmation to the requirement. Then testing is part of quality assurance. And the last point is again very important. Quality control is an end of phase activity. Let's try to understand this. These are the different phases of software development. And if you are in the requirement stage, and once the requirement is written, the requirement undergoes testing process as a part of quality control. Similarly, for other stages, once the activity of that stage is done, quality control comes into picture. And that is why we say quality control is the end of phase activity. Thank you. In this lecture, we will talk about defect, root cause, and its effect. This topic is marked as K2. So at the end of this lecture, you shall be in a position to differentiate what is root cause and what is its effect. So let's begin by defining root cause. It is the earliest action or condition that contributes to creating the defects. This means that when you find a defect, you also have to find the first condition that causes that defect. And we will understand this with the help of an example. Suppose this is the requirement. Once the speed is more than 115 km per hour, red light shall glow. So here, the speed needs to be more than 115 km per hour. After getting this feature, the customer is unhappy because customer checked this device and made the observation that there is a defect. Why? Because when he sets the speed to 116, he expected the red light to be on, but he found that it's still off. Now, to figure out why is this failure here, we have to do a root cause analysis. So here we are in the testing stage, but we have to go back a step to the implementation stage or coding stage. Here, we find that there is a condition that was implemented incorrectly. And the condition is if speed is equal to or greater than 150. However, our job is not done yet. Remember, we have to find the earliest condition. This means we have to go one stage back again. And the next stage is requirement and design stage. And in this stage, we found that some of the developer have written this system requirement. Red light shall glow when speed is more than 150. So instead of 115, they wrote 150. And because of this, the implementation was done incorrectly. And we found the defect in the coding stage. However, our job is not done yet, since we have to find the earliest condition. And when we investigated more, it was found that since the communication was verbal, this problem occurred. Now comes the point which you need to understand. Now, your job is to identify effect, failure, fault, and root cause out of these statements. So customer is unhappy is a effect and observation made by the customer is a failure. These two statements are defect and all these problems occur due to the miscommunication. So this is the root cause. So we don't stop at this point. Now we need to find the solution to avoid such problem. So now we have to look for the action and the action is any further communication will be done via email. So this is how you have to find out which one of these statements are failure, effect, fault, or root cause. We will see one more example to illustrate what we learned about defect and root cause analysis. and here is the life cycle of defect root cause analysis. This life cycle starts with a customer complaint, which is also the effect. Why is he complaining? Because he has come across a failure. He has received incorrect interest payment calculation. So the customer is trying to calculate his interest but received an incorrect result, and this was a failure. When we analyze this failure, we find that it was caused by a single line of incorrect code. When we further investigate this defect, we find out that wrong code was written because of the product owner's misunderstanding of how to calculate interest. This was the root cause of the defect that made the customer complain. So, we have this information. The product owner did not know how to calculate interest. But we cannot stop here. We have an entire team. So, how is that product owner does not know how to do the interest calculation? So, what we have to do next is called action. We figure out what to do so this never happens again. We train the product owner in interest calculation. This way, they will not repeat this mistake again. So, you see how everything is connected. This is how root cause analysis works. It starts from the effect, that is the complaint, and ends with an action, that is our method to correct the root cause. Now we will have a look into why we need to do a root cause analysis. The first point is to prevent a significant number of future defects from being introduced. We want to make sure that new defects don't crop up in the future. The second point is to reduce the occurrence of similar defect in the future. So, we don't want this interest calculation error to crop up again in our system. And the third point is to improve our process. In this lecture, we will address a very important point, that is 7 testing principles. So let's start with the first principle. The first principle says that testing shows the presence of defect, not their absence. Let's break this down. The first point is, testing can show that defects are present. So when we carry out testing and find a defect, then we know that there is a problem with the software. So testing can show the presence of defect. The second point is that testing cannot prove that there is no defects. Just because you have not found a defect does not mean that there are no defects in the software. So testing cannot prove absence of defect. And the final point is that testing reduces the probability of undiscovered defects. So let's try to understand this point with an example. Suppose you have 20 defects in a software, and when you perform testing, you found 5 defects out of it. So, you had 20 defects and you found 5 defects. The remaining defects in the software are 15. So, this is why we say that testing can show that defects are present. We found 5. So, we know for very sure that 5 defects are there in the software. But, we cannot prove that there are no defects in the software. We found 5 out of 20 defects, but there are 15 left and that we don't know about. So we cannot prove that there are no defects in the software. And finally, testing reduces the probability of undiscovered defect. And how does this happen? Initially, we had 20 defects, but we found 5. So only 15 are left out. So we had reduced the number of defects in the customer's product. So this is how first principle works. Now let's move to the second principle. Principle 2 states that exhaustive testing is impossible. Please remember this point. Exhaustive testing is impossible. The first point to understand about this is, testing everything is not feasible. Just because we have a software does not mean that we have to test every bit of it. The second point is, whenever we do testing, it has to depend on risk analysis. What is the risk of that particular system? Depending upon that, we have to see what kind of testing is required. Then we have to focus on the different testing techniques and what are the priorities of different features. We cannot just test everything. We need to prioritize certain parts based on how important they are. And the final point is to focus on test effort. When we are testing a feature, we need to know how much effort is required. This is why exhaustive testing is impossible. Testing requires a certain amount of effort, and that is why testing everything is not feasible. And let's try to understand this with the help of an example. Say, a customer requirement is the following. LED shall glow when speed is between 15 and 90 km per hour. One way of testing this requirement is to do a boundary value analysis. For this test, we have taken 6 values. On one end we have 14, 15, 16, and on the other hand we have 89, 90 and 91. So when we do the testing, the LED shall not glow at 14 and 15, and on the other hand at 90 and 91. It should only work for 16 and 89. So only by using 6 values we can test the software and say whether it meets the customer requirement or not. But it is also possible to do the same test by considering all the values between 15 and 90. But that will consume a lot of time and effort. And by using a boundary value analysis, we serve our purpose. That means that it is not necessary to take all the values between 15 and 90. And that is the reason we say that testing each and everything is not feasible. But the important point over here which we need to understand is, if the sufficient amount of time and effort is given, it is possible to test everything, but it is impractical. So this line is very important. Sometimes it is possible to test all the scenarios, but it is not practical to do so because of the time and effort involved in it. So this is all about second principle. Let's look at the third principle of testing now. Principle 3 states that early testing saves time and money. Let's break this down. The first point is that static and dynamic test activities should be started as early as possible. What does that mean? It means that we should start testing as early as possible. Whether it is a static testing or it's a dynamic testing, whichever is possible, we have to start that one. Now let's have a look into the second point. Early testing is sometimes referred to as shift left. What is that? Look here. As I am talking about early testing, I am shifting to the left of the diagram. The very first stage of testing is at the leftmost corner of the software development lifecycle. So early testing is sometimes called as shift left. And finally, we come to the last point. It helps us to reduce or eliminate costly changes. Let's try to understand this with the help of an example. So here is a very popular graph about the cost and time of finding defects. As you can see, in the requirement stage, the cost of locating a defect is at the lowest. When you move to the design stage, it becomes a little costlier. Then, as you move to the build stage and then to the test stage, it gets more and more expensive. Finally, at the live use, it is the costliest to discover defect in the product. So, why does this happen? To understand this, we need our lifecycle diagram. Suppose we find a defect in the implementation stage, which is the build stage. Just because it was found at this stage does not mean that error happened here. It might be in the design stage or in the system requirement stage. It can also be that someone misunderstood the user's requirement, because of which every subsequent stage was wrong and we implemented it incorrectly. So now, to correct this one defect, we have to go back and correct these documents. And correcting all these documents will take a lot of time, labor and resource, which means that it will cost a lot of money. And that is why principle 3 states, perform testing as early as possible. Now we are on the fourth principle of testing. Principle 4 states that defect clusters together. To understand this, let's start with the first point. Sometimes a small number of modules can contain most of the defects. And point number 2 is, those defects can be responsible for most of the operational failures. Though these are only few modules, the defect present in them can cause operational failures. What is operational failure? It is when the product is in use and fail to perform according to the expectation. So, If we can identify the modules or the part of the software that contain this defect, this will help us to reduce or eliminate costly changes. If we find them during testing, then they don't crop up during the live use, and we can save the expenses on correcting them. So that's the fourth principle, to identify the modules where most of the defects are clustered together. Now we are on the fifth principle of testing. Principle 5 states, beware of pesticide paradox. What does this mean? Let's find out. Point number 1. The same test no longer finds defect. During testing, if you have already found a defect in a code, then it is unlikely that you will find a defect again. Unless there is a big change in the code, you will find no more errors since you already found one and corrected it. So, then what we have to do? Let's cover it in point number 2. To detect new defects, exist test case and test data may need update. So, you either have to update the test case or the data in it to be able to find new defects in it. And the third point is, when you are performing automated regression testing, the pesticide paradox has a beneficial outcome. When you run automated testing, you are actually running scripts. So, if you run the same script again and again, it is highly unlikely that you will find new defects. But if you update your script, add new values to it, or add new test case to it, then there is a possibility of discovering new defects. So, the pesticide paradox is very beneficial when you are performing an automated testing. Now let's see an example to understand this point. Suppose there is a software with 20 defects in it. When you run your script for the first time, you found 5 defects. Then the software is left with 15 defects. Now, if you don't change the test script and you run it for the second time and third time, you will find no more new defects. No matter how many times you run it, you cannot find the remaining 15 defects. This is because you are running the same scripts. In order to find a new defect, you have to update your scripts. So that is why we said the same test will no longer find defect. And to detect new one, existing test cases needs change. Now let's cover the last two principles, Principle 6 and Principle 7. Principle 6 states, testing is context dependent. This means that the type of testing will depend upon the kind of product being tested. This is why testing is context dependent. So let's start breaking this down. Point number 1. Safety critical industry control software is tested differently from an e-commerce mobile app. So a mobile application and a safety critical software will be tested differently. We cannot use the same process for both the applications. Point number 2. Testing in an agile project is done differently than testing in a sequential development model. Our method of testing in the agile project is completely different from how we test in a sequential development model. And the final point is about the e-commerce. So as we already discussed in point number 1, e-commerce project is tested completely different from the mobile application or from a safety critical application. And that is why principle 6 emphasizes that testing is context dependent. Principle 7 states that absence of error is a fallacy. If you remember, we have already covered this in principle 1 and 2. Let's deconstruct that. Point number 1. In an organization, it is expected that tester can run all possible tests and find all possible defects. This expectation is completely wrong. We cannot run all possible tests and we cannot find all the possible defects. Point number 2 says, Principle 2 and Principle 1 respectively tells us that this is impossible. If you recall, Principle 2 states that exhaustive testing is impossible, and 1 says that we cannot find all the bugs in the system. So we can claim to have found a bug, but we cannot claim that there is no defect left in the software. Further, it is a fallacy. So this is an incorrect belief that tester can find all the mistakes that exist in the software. Our final point is, thoroughly testing all specified requirements and fixing all defects found could still produce a system that is difficult to use. Even if we do everything, there can still be environmental condition, unfound defect, or other factors that can cause the product to fail, and it's not in our hand. So this is why we cannot say that there are no error left in the software. If someone claims that, then it is a mistaken belief.